it immediately sounds like a very classic American 70s rock song. And then as the song progresses, like with a side of country as well, you
Yes,
know, the sort of fucked up country, you know. Hey everybody, and welcome to another episode of The Audiophiles. My name's John, that guy's Andy, and Andy has got a song for me to listen to. I shall go off and react to it, come back, and then we shall all point our fingers at Andy and say, why, in God's name, why? Andy, what have you got for me?
That is all par for the course. I have got a band that I know you're familiar with, but I don't know how familiar with them you are, especially their later stuff and your penchant for loving earlier stuff by artists. But this is a song by the Decemberists, and this is off the last album that they put out, which was in 2018, and the track is called Sucker's Prayer.
Yeah, not a chance. I've got one album by them.
Okay, yeah, that again, par for the course.
the Crane Wife.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, this it definitely came out on the 2018 album, and it was also, as you'll see by the video, used in a soundtrack for Suicide Squad. I never saw the movie, but I do adore the song. So go off, give it a listen. And just because I like it doesn't mean you have to. So let me know what you think about it on the other side.
Will do.
Okay.
So to stop him as he's just getting started. This sounds like a real sort of classic 70s American rock to me. That's got a really nice sound to it. I'll just go back a little bit so he can start singing properly again. Yeah, sounds good. I have to say, it's not the same, but it kind of reminds me where it's stopped, dropped off, kicked back in again. It's a bit of the old Don't Let Me Down by the Beatles, the same sort of way they do it, which is really interesting.
Took my glasses off and went to find a pond. Stuffing rocks into the pockets of my pants. When I waded in, those currents carry them away. I wanna love somebody, but I don't know how. I've been so long, lonely, and it's getting me
Not really. That was a really odd solo. The way he was, it was fighting against the notes all the way. I reckon about here. Short song, so we can listen to it again. Enjoyed that. There's loads of little touches in there. It does sound to me like a screwed up country song as well. I love the piano was doing all this phrasing and stuff and introducing stuff and punctuating bits at the end of lines. The bass growling away every now and then. The backing vocals again gave it that 70s vibe and a bit of that country vibe as well. There's a dynamics in the song as well. And I liked the ending, the way it was just a cappella at the end and then stopped. It was like really abrupt, really stark. This is good stuff. Nice one, Andy.
All right.
Okay. Yeah, me return.
It's so great to see you. So what do you think?
I really, really like this a lot. There was a lot to like about it as well. So I probably didn't get everything about the song because there was lots of elements and lots of stuff going on. But I have some of my thoughts, and you've got no choice but to listen to them.
Well, I have solicited them, so feel free.
It starts off, it was a great start, actually. And I sort of stopped it after about 10 seconds. It immediately sounds like a very classic American 70s rock song. And then as the song progresses, like with a side of country as well, you
Yes,
know, a sort of fucked up country, you know. And then about a minute into it, after the sort of first bit, and then the chorus, I actually had a sort of a weird vibe. It's not the same song at all, but the way it came in and out and constructed, it really reminded me of "Don't Let Me Down" by the Beatles. The way it
Oh,
sort of comes in
okay.
and out, and if you listen to that and listen again,
No, I can
there's
already
loads of
hear it. I can
songs.
already hear it. I actually weirdly did the same thing, and it was but it wasn't with "Don't Let Me Down," which I think is an excellent shout. The very beginning of the song, when the music first starts, I got a weird Oasis vibe from it.
All right.
Where it was like, what's the song? Maybe "Cannonball" or something like that, or whatever it is. Like, "Faster Than a Cannonball, Where Were You When We Were Getting High?" That song.
Oh, Champagne Supernova.
Yes, Champagne Supernova. That's the one. Oh my God. The audience from the UK is going to kill me for that. But newsflash, I'm lukewarm on Oasis. They're all right to me, but now it's really going to come. But that intro really reminded me of like the guitarishness of that song in Oasis and the way it starts. So I think when you know what you know about Oasis, when it comes to the Beatles, we're probably both right.
So there's so much to this. I didn't really get that much of the lyrics, but what I got was different elements. And so I'll go through the elements and how they came to me as I was listening to it. I was really, really concentrated on the music a lot because I was thoroughly enjoying it. So great piano, brilliant phrasing, the way it came in and out. It was like a highlight pen going over certain parts of the song. And so, listen to this bit, or this bit's coming up, you know, and it just worked really, really well. The backing vocals and the harmonies were wonderful, and it gave it that extra sort of country-ish tinge. Mm-hmm. And I think I heard in places slide guitar as well, coming in, particularly in the sort of chorusy main bits. I really like the sort of keys, I don't know exactly what they were, whether it was a synth or an organ or whatever, but they would put all these chords in the pre-chorus, sort of ramping it up, ready to go. And I also picked up only occasionally the occasional sort of bass growl that was up, just coming in when everything was like about to kick in again, which was really nice. I thought the guitar solo was really unusual, and I did pull it back and listen to it again. Because it was like the guitar player, was fighting against the notes. I mean, it felt this tension and struggle. You know, it was almost like he was strangling the guitar. It was fantastic. Really effective. And that's I loved it. It was ringing out the notes and just like it was fighting back. You know, there were fantastic dynamics throughout the whole song. You know, light and shade, bringing it up and down. Really sort of drawing you in, and I found myself sort of counting the beats towards the latter part of the song, anticipating the next bit. Yes, this bit's going to come in, this bit. So when the ending came, when they went the last line a cappella and then stopped, it came as a shock actually to me, because I was really wrapped up at that point. But I really liked it because it gave it a very abrupt and stark ending, considering the subject matter from what I sort of got. What I tried to do is concentrate so I could just get, I got three lines. So I managed to get those down. And he says, I want to love somebody, but I don't know how. I've been lonely so long and it's getting me down. I want to throw my body in the river and drown. So, you know, all good human stuff there. So it's obviously, he's not a happy bunny, you know?
No.
Talking about down the road and doing a sucker's prayer. But the first bit, I thought I heard, and I might be wrong here, but he says something about grim something Baudelaire, it sounded like. And I thought, ooh, that's classy, throwing in a bit of French poets, you know? And it could be something else completely different, but that's what my mind picked up. So it probably says more about my mind. But overall, because I didn't get the lyrics very well, but obviously someone who's not very happy. That's an understatement. But the song itself was wonderful, and I really, really enjoyed every second of it.
That's awesome. That is great. That's great. I'm so glad you liked it. So, I mean, you'd be hard pressed not to, but I'm glad that you brought up the fact that it flirted with
his voice. Yeah, one thing I didn't mention it about his voice, it's lovely as well. Really, really nice voice. You know,
especially for a tune like this, I think, you know, it just fit the mood so well. Yeah. There's sort of a desperate tone to it while it's also still quite melodic. For those in the listening audience who are less familiar than us, the Decemberists are an American indie rock band that formed in 2000. They're from Portland, Oregon, and the band consists of Colin Malloy on lead vocals, guitar, and he's the principal songwriter. Chris Funk, who is a guitar and multi-instrumentalist, and don't we love those utility players who can do a bit of everything? Jenny Conley, piano, keyboards, and accordion, her work you spoke of when you talked about the keys. Nate Query on bass, those rumbling bass lines, and John Moen on drums. Their EP, which was titled Five Songs, very cleverly, just five songs, which is exactly what it was, came out in 2001 and was self-released. And they really picked up a lot of steam for that, to the point where they've had like 23 years of kind of unmitigated success to some degree. They have been nominated for Grammys in the past, which is really cool. And yeah, the lyrics, which you kind of spoke on, very much, this song has been, and other songs sort of this ilk that Malloy's written in the past have been described as, and forgive the term, but this kind of, it's got a bit morbid, but it makes me laugh, a suicide sing-along, which is kind of what this has shades of that going on. They're also really notorious for like writing songs about historical events, which is kind of cool. And we've talked about that in the past with P-Dor. Yeah. And you've mentioned some other tunes that kind of cut from that same cloth of extrapolating historical anecdotes and writing songs about them through the vantage point of someone in that narrative, which is really interesting to me. I think that's so clever and really shows a higher level of songwriting, if you ask me. This is not one of them, though. I do love this song. This is more of like an introspective song, I suppose. But the lyrics go, I was not ready for the road. I was so discontent to wear that heavy load. And so I got down on my knees, made a sucker's prayer, like Rimbaud to Baudelaire before. So yeah, you were right.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah.
It's actually, sorry to be a pedant, but I just can't help myself. It's actually pronounced Rambo, which Rambo? Is so funny. Yeah, every time you hear it, Rambo.
Oh, I think of John Rambo. Yes, exactly. I think of Stallone in the cuts.
So not one, but two French.
Yeah. Sorry, I saw R.I.M. and went Rimbo. Okay, Rambo. Yeah,
it's like French for wine is VAM, but it's V-I-M.
Okay, that checks out then. And when nobody,
I don't know why I'm teaching you bloody French. I'm sorry.
Please come on. This is going to come in handy absolutely no time at all. So please,
north of the border,
that's right.
The draft.
That's where I'll head. And when nobody did respond, I took my glasses off and went to find a pond, stuffing rocks into the pockets of my pants. And when I waded in, those currents carried them away. I want to love somebody, but I don't know how. I've been so long lonely, and it's getting me down. I want to throw my body into the river and drown. I want to love somebody, but I don't know how. And then there's a really nice guitar work. So if you're lost along the way, and if you're thinking that will always be the case, won't you listen to my plea? You'll make a sucker's prayer. Just go and leave it that way. I want to love somebody, but I don't know how. I've been so long lonely, and it's getting me down. I want to throw my body in the river and drown. I want to love somebody, but I don't know how. And then there's that acapella outro, which is that last line said again and repeated. So this is, a very sad song that is written in a way that kind of like makes you smile and sing along with it, which is a really odd dynamic. And we've talked about that before in the past as well. A little quote here from Malloy about the song, Sucker's Prayer was a song that had sort of been kicking around for a little bit. We'd actually played it live the past year and a half or so. I think it really grew out of finding that chord, the A chord, and sitting on it. I think I was referencing like a Karen Dalton song when I was first messing around with it. The song just kind of really blossomed from that. It kind of turned into a country song. I didn't think I was super comfortable with it being a country song, so I made it weird. So that's where you get like, it's not exactly country. It's like weird, messed up country.
Yeah, yeah.
So yeah, that is the crux of the tune and the band. Thank you so much for giving a listen. And I'm really, really stoked that you liked it. Maybe we can revisit more of their more recent stuff, considering you're only really familiar with that, I believe, their second full-length album. So there's, I think, five to pick from. So yeah, there's other great songs by these guys out there. But thanks for giving it a listen, John. I appreciate you. And Everybody out there in the listening audience, if you're familiar with the Decemberists, please feel free to shout out tunes that you think we might like. If you're not familiar with the Decemberists or this song, let us know what you think down there in the comment section. We love engaging with you guys and seeing what y'all think. But with all that being said, make sure you like, share, subscribe if you feel so inclined. We really appreciate it. We're a growing channel and we hope to continue to grow with y'all. And all that, let's just put a bow on things and say we will see you all the next time we give a good scurrying about and rummaging through the audio files. See you guys.